You're welcome.
And what we do is it can either be question and answer, conversation, or you can just talk. I normally begin by asking guys, before you joined the Army, what were you doing for a living?
I was a student at Purdue University, and I joined the Enlisted Reserve Corps, but I had about a year and a half of college before I went into the Army. I left Purdue in 1943, around Christmas time, and decided I was going to do something, go in the Army, and I left school. And I was still in the Enlisted Reserve Corps, but I somehow it went on in the spring, and I was working there for a while, and then had my appendix out, and that delayed my action. Finally, I got inducted. Instead of any other program, I was inducted on 24th of June in 1943. And that was a great day. My grandfather was in Rotary, and he knew the colonel at the Fort Custer. And so I had a choice of where to go. They told me I could choose where I would go. So I chose Fort Sill because I was in the artillery ROTC at Purdue. I thought I was still interested in that. And so that's where I went. I went in and got through all the tests at the camp Fort Custer. And I finally was put on a train, and anyway, before that, Bill Pertell, a good friend of mine, we went in together and we got our uniform on, and we had nice little jackets with lapels on it. It looked like, you know, an officer, and we thought, well, we'll go downtown Battle Creek, and we would see where an officer was coming walking. There were a lot of soldiers in town, you know, so we'd walk over to so we could practice saluting. But anyway, that was a funny thing that happened. Got to Fort Sill, and I was in basic training, a flash and sound battalion, which was a means of locating enemy guns in battle. Anyway, it was terrific training, and the surveying was the big thing, and a lot of mathematics with logarithms, and a special big sound machine that was about 10 feet long that they plugged in microphones in the, and it's an archaic thing now, I'm sure. But I completed my basic in that field, and then the 27th of November, a truck came out and took me out of the field and said I was going to college, ASDP. And so the truck took me, and I ended up in Oklahoma A&M. And that's Oklahoma State now. And this was a STAR unit, and I was waiting to be assigned to some college course. And so, but I was there, and I actually went on a furlough because my father was sick and had an operation, and so I was asked to come home by the Red Cross. And so I did go home during that time. But it was about 3 months almost, but in February, I was assigned to New Mexico A&M in Las Cruces, New Mexico. Now that was a big program, and we merrily got on our way, and it was nice weather down there. I played some tennis on the side, but lo and behold, the whole program was nationally canceled. And they needed, and I say they needed cannon fodder in the services. Anyway, the whole group in Las Cruces was sent to Camp Barkley, Texas. The majority of them, I'm not sure everyone went there, but majority of people did. And of course, I saw other people later that I had been in Las Cruces, but it was a pretty big program. So I went in and went through classification to be assigned. Well, I was interviewed, and they decided I should be a topical draftsman in the engineers. And I thought, well, you know, I don't know what's in front of me, but it sounded like an interesting thing. Combat engineers, I'm not sure if I was too thrilled with that, but I decided that was okay, and I started walking out with some papers, and I saw a fraternity brother. I saw his ring, and he said, well, sit down, and I'll look over your record here. And so he looked over my record and thought, with all your athletic skills and everything, I've got a job for you. I mean, it would be in special service. Probably wouldn't have even been and I didn't really, I wasn't too enthused about it, but he said, this is really a deal. There's an opening. And so he went and started pulling papers. He came back, and just then the captain, a little squirt, came over, looked at me and said, 521 basic. And I said, I couldn't say anything because he was in charge, and the lieutenant didn't say anything. So it was and so here I leave the building, and I'm in 521 basic. Well, it's 521 basic is infantry basic. Well, I'd had sharpshooting stuff in the artillery and handle, and you know, fired M1s, so here I am. I'm in the C-66 Armored Infantry Battalion. So I had to accept that, but I couldn't do much about it. So I thought I'd do the best I could. So anyway. Okay, I'm embarking. Oh, and anyway, so I went through a basic and training. You know, it was training, really. Most of it was, a lot of the men already had the basic, but, and I had the basic good enough, but I had, I took the training, and it ended up that we, so this was in March. This was in March when I entered there, and so we shipped out. Or I had a big furlough to go to Battle Creek in the meantime that summer. But they were trying to get everything ready so that we could ship out and go to overseas. Well, we were. My furlough ended on the 3rd of August, and the 7th of September, everyone left. I mean, we left on the train, and we had packed all the guns and stuff, or a lot of it, in Cosmoline, and protected it. And so anyway, we took a 3-day train ride across the country and ended up at Camp Shanks, New Jersey, and which was right across from New York City. So we had a little time off there for a couple of days, and we got ready to ship out. Well, we ended up embarking on the 18th of September on the Empress of Australia, a great cruise ship.
I was about to say, everyone I've spoken to so far has had an Empress of Australia story.
So
tell me.
There were a lot of people on that that ship. It was an old hulk of a thing. When in its heyday, it must have been pretty nice, but with all the stuff torn out of it, it was just a big tub. And the people didn't like the food. It was all British lamb or goat, they said, but... I always liked lamb myself, but it was pretty heavy stuff we had, and seasickness was a big deal. Gambling was a big deal on the ship. crap games went on and big money switched, I lost my share. So anyway, we arrived and thought we were going to go to France, and we were diverted to England. And so we went there, and we ended up in the Tidworth Barracks for training at the time, and you know, practice things, and it was sort of it wasn't the warmest place to be. The little stoves we had, sort of the coal burning stoves, were helped to heat it up a little. But at the same time, I did get to London, and I did get to see a big cathedral in Salisbury, which I was real amazed with. But anyway, we finished there, and of course, in London, it was you know, bombing was happening all the time, and buzz bombs were coming over the city of London, and you could hear them, and so when we were in London, you could hear this buzz bomb coming. All of a sudden, it would stop the sound. That meant it's coming down, and somewhere there was a big explosion after a time, and it was a scary deal. But man, they've been living through this, and probably they've had even worse days than then before that. And I think we were giving them more. They were combating against the Germans a lot better at that time. But anyway, we shipped out and arrived, left England on an LST, and we landed in Le Havre, and we were shuttled by truck to an open field. So our infantry unit, the battalion, and whoever was there, all ended up in this field. Pitch rain, it was, and we didn't have any tents, or I don't know what they expected, but two fellas, Orville Holderman and T.M. Walker and I were sort of buddies, and we had bought some book on bridge, and so we ended up getting in this barn and up in a hayloft, and we started practicing playing bridge, or getting bridge hands, and anyway, we got out of the rain, and I don't remember the details or when we ate or the next or what happened, but we finally ended up being gotten trucks, and we were shipped to Lunéville, France. Well, that was a long ride of 300 and some miles, I guess. So it was getting up near the front, towards the 7th Army front, probably more than, I don't know exactly where the other one was, but we did leave the 4th Armored on the front lines on December 7th or the 6th. And I have written down here in my notes that, anyway, the 7th and the 8th of December, we went on an attack. But before that, I said I was sick. Well, I had had some spaghetti or something that we had in big, and I had the worst stomach, a gastric problem. And the medic couldn't really solve my problems, I guess, and he gave me a shot of morphine. And so that put me out for about 2 days. And so I was in a house, and one time I just, you know, just conked out. And they were doing things, and I said we had our first combat. Where the heck am I? Anyway, on the 8th of December, 44, we went on an attack, and I stayed in the half track. Now, it was probably because I was sick at that time. And anyway, the 10th of December, I show that I joined the company, and the 11th of December, 1944, we took our second objective, the village of Geising. And I know that I was out, I was moving around then, and I was riding on the back of a tank, and we were going up these railroad tracks. And I guess at that time I was to be a runner for the 3rd Platoon. And I had a carbine then. So I wasn't in a squad with my M1 rifle. I was had a carbine for flexibility and lightness, I guess. And so we went roaring up this railroad tracks, and the next thing I know, they stop, and I hear a command, "Rich, get out, go out over that field and see what's on the other side of that hill." So anyway, so I get out, and I run up, and we can see a church steeple, you know, that's down in a valley, but it's up over, there's something over the hill and trees up there. And so I went dashing up there and zigzagging up there, and I got up the top, you know, and signaled everything was all clear. No firing. So we pursued on. That was my big first encounter there. I went back to the tanks then, and we later that same day took another small town of Bettweiler, I think. And then on the 15th, we moved to the rear. So we were staying in little villages and towns at that time. And we weren't really fighting, or we weren't shooting much or anything like that. And on the 22nd of December, we went up the front lines again. And so we actually spent Christmas up there, and just holding on this line. And there we could hear fighting in the distance or guns, but not, we weren't getting particular action then, but the enemy was in sight almost. And anyway, Christmas, our mess kitchen came up, and with full regalia made a Christmas dinner. That, and most of these guys were in foxholes, and I guess because I was a runner, I wasn't in a foxhole, and which was, I guess, okay with me. But then I was either in the headquarters section then or something. And but our dinner was really super. I mean, it had turkey and, you know, the full trimmings like they get. And so that was a real treat for all the men. So by the 26th, the day after Christmas, in fact, I think we started moving out that same day, Christmas Day. They cleaned the trucks up and we started moving out. And the next day we were in way back in some town. I have Benistroff, but I'm not sure if that's any close to where we were. Anyway, and I say, January 1st came, New Year begins. Yay! Terribly cold. And I mean, it was cold. And we did have a cold winter. The 8th of January, I show being in Niederschäferstein. And that's the way I pronounce Niederschäferstein. And whether the spelling's right or not, but it's a long word. And that's where we were before we were declared to go on a an attack, and we were told you know, specific things, that the enemy was by this woods and Steinwell Woods, And so here we were told, and I think, if I'm not mistaken, and I don't have it written down, it seemed like we were told this one night and it was delayed. And then the next night we were put on alert again. And so we went on attack. And we were taken by half track, as we usually were, and the drivers let us off at a designated spot right by this canal. And we got out, and we filed off across the little bridge that was put in by the engineers, and it was a lot of snow, and it was cold, and we followed the leader more or less, and it was pitch dark and foggy, and I've heard more stories about what really happened, but we ended up going out, and we all had our guns ready and hand grenades, and we had white sheets over us for camouflage, you know, in the snow. And we put these white sheets on over our helmets and over our bodies as best we could. And so I was fairly near the company commander, and we came to a spot, and apparently I was been told later, and didn't know it at the time, that we actually had run into some an outlook or German, a couple of German soldiers were stationed out there, so they knew we were coming, and one of them escaped, so I know they knew we were coming. And anyway, one guy said, well, which way do you go or something, and they, well, we'll go that way, but it was so dark you really couldn't see the guys around you hardly at the time. Well, we turned and started moving in a certain direction, and I would say I felt like, well, if we were gonna be confronted, it would be on our left side. And And all of a sudden, they opened up on us, and that was our big day. And on this flat field, the machine gun started raking in the field, and everyone hit the ground, and the whistle blew, and I think it was the company commander, you know, said fire, and. So here we are, and I fired, I could see flashes, you know, gun flashes, and I fired about 15 rounds from my carbine, the machine gun, the bullets kept hammering the ground, and I don't know, unless someone has some grenade launchers. That's what my thought was, that if you had a grenade launcher on your M1 rifle, you could fire these grenades like mortars at this area. And I don't know if anyone did then, but you know, it was sort of a split second decision what to do. But anyway, the machine gun fire, and if you ever heard of a German machine gun firing about 1,100 rounds a minute, it's a hell of a thing. But anyway, here I am flat down. Now after firing, I decided it wasn't happening, because our firing stopped, and people were hurt badly, and a lot of moaning, and all of a sudden, and it was getting light now. And I didn't really have a contact with anyone that they were ahead of me, or they were far enough away that I didn't talk to them, or I never had contact. anyway, the firing kept going on the field, so just endlessly at first. And finally it got light, and the moaning was still going on, and there were some tank came up on the other side. I could see in my, turned my head in my helmet sideways, and I could see the tank, and it got hit. Now, I don't know what time it was exactly, but then, but and people jumping out of it. It was an American tank, and so it was, things were going on all around, and we didn't have any artillery that was coming in, you know, directly ahead of us or anything, so we weren't getting the artillery that maybe would have helped us at that time. So anyway, it got so that I think the company commander was killed within the first 10 seconds of the firing, immediately when this thing started. And I don't know the story of the other leaders and platoon leaders, and exactly, I've heard of, you know, since, you know, after all these years, I hear different stories. And anyway, it was a terrible day, and okay, all I have in my notes is, became a prisoner of war. Well, finally, I moved back about 15, I'd say maybe 15 yards during the day, slowly, but then this was even before it got real light, and I decided I couldn't go any farther. It was uphill and a little bit. And finally, I just said, well, I'm going to wait for darkness, and I think there are others that did the same thing. And so here we were all day long in the snow, and I never thought in the world I could stand that long a time, and that with the weather the way it was. But somehow or other, I could turn my head without moving my helmet. I could turn and look sideways. Finally, and I kept moving my feet all day to try to keep them circulation, but they got pretty cold. But isn't it funny? I finally, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and that's about the time it was, the Germans came out, because everything stopped. Their firing had stopped most of the time by then, and there wasn't any firing from our side. And I think some mortars landed in some part of our group, and white phosphorus was actually came in from somewhere. And whether they were German, I think we were too close to the Germans for them to fire mortars at us in this location. That's the way I was hoping. But there were some heavy-duty mortar fires in some of our area, I think. So anyway, the Germans came out, and I guess I wasn't going to wait for darkness, because, you know, they were going to take your boots off, or they were checking the whole area. So other people were starting to get up, and I said, well, I guess I'll get up, and then I was a prisoner. That's about that fast. And we were told to pick up or look at for any wounded. So I wanted to see if I could walk, because that was the biggest problem, is even standing up then. And I apparently was standing up and walking around on something down there. And so we started looking around, and I was with some other men from our company, and I can't even tell you who they were now, that were up, and we were told to check on if there were wounded and see if we could help any wounded. So, and about that time, there was this, I moved over, and this one guy was there on the ground, and half of his face was shot away almost, and I said, with it talking to myself, sort of, I said, well, I don't think we can help him. And he turned up, all of a sudden he turned his head up and said, what do you mean don't help me? Oh, God, you know, just about, I couldn't believe it. I thought, I didn't think he was even conscious. Anyway, so he was a person we had to help. Well, they brought a litter, and the handle, one handle was broken off, and somehow I ended up with that end. But you put a man on that litter, carrying it, and with our feet so bad, it was a terrible job. I mean, it was so hard to do, and we kept going, and we cut across over to this road that went to our left as we were lying on the, and that on the other side of that was where the tank was, and their attack over there, and we walked up the road, carrying this litter. Well, by the time we got up to the, I think it was a little, there was a little hill we went up, and after we went by the position where the Germans were, I think, along the line by the road, artillery came in, and it was our artillery, and it was going over our heads, like, it seemed like it was about 10 feet over our heads, landing in this field. And so we hit the ground with, in the middle of this road, with this weight that we were carrying, this wounded man. Anyway, that the artillery stopped, and we finally got over this hill and went down by this pillbox, which was part of the Maginot Line. And that was a apparently an aid station of the Germans, and that's where we left this person. And I don't know his name, never found out, and I feel badly that I didn't ever find that out. But and then we were just lined up there, we were searched by some of the troops, and at the time I had a wristwatch, and one guy asked me, you know, if I had a watch, and I said, and I shook my head, no, and I pushed my sleeve up. Anyway, they didn't search me any closer, so I did retain my watch at that time, which I was thankful for. But to sort of speed this up, we were taken that. Well, we were bombed at that time. Right up there, we had some American or Allied plane came along and shot this one tank, hit this one tank, and anyway, it was sort of exciting that we were here in this middle of this battle or something, but. Things quieted down after that, and so we were, and it was getting dark then, I think. Anyway, we were led away, so we walked, and we were going to go somewhere, and we went to the Rhine River, and we went up the Rhine River, along the edge of the Rhine River, and I don't have it in my notes, but this one guard had a bottle he took a big shot of what do you call German booze?
Oh, schnapps.
Schnapps. Anyway, I said, bonbon for schnapps, or something. He only had a little left. So I gave him this candy I had, and he gave me the bottle. So I finished his bottle of schnapps. And we threw the, and then he threw the, I know, he took that bottle and he threw it into the Rhine River. So that was a interesting time. We got to a place where there was some sort of a boat or a ferry, a small, either wire, some way, maybe it was connected to a wire or something going across the Rhine. And some people said they went across on a pontoon bridge. This was some sort of a craft that went in a straight line over there, but most of the prisoners got in there, the ones that were mobile right then. And so that's where we went. And we crossed the Rhine into Germany. We were in Alsace-Lorraine previous to that. And so we were taken to a, we said it was a, after marching somewhere, we were taken to this schoolhouse, I guess is what they said it was. And that's where they, and we were interrogated. And so, you know, we were told not to give any information, just name, rank, and serial number. And this interrogator was a very, spoke perfect English. He was friendly, and he asked all kinds of questions, and I said, well, you know, all I can give you is my name, rank, and serial number. And so he started telling me all the who we were, instead of me telling him, he told me who we were, and what, maybe from my reaction he would know that that was right or something, but he knew it was the 12th Armored Division, part of it. In fact, I guess he, as I recall, he might have even known, I don't know if he knew our unit, I don't think I remember that. That he said that. But anyway, so that was a, we went to the, we left there and we walked into the Black Forest, I guess it was that area, ended up in this place that I thought was a cavalry barn. Anyway, after all these years, I'm so confused about this time that that's all I can say is that we stayed in this one cavalry barn, and people are telling me we were actually in 5A, Stammlager 5A, and in Ludwigsburg area. Well, we had walked through the Black Woods and for quite a ways by then, and so and we got had some food there, and we were sent out in the woods to pick up wood that some loggers were cutting up in the forest, and I guess we brought that back to this cavalry barn. That's what I've been told, that was a cavalry barn or something. But I can't really verify what exactly happened at this time. But I know that we left there and we boarded a train, and I thought it was at Stuttgart. And I was told, no, it was in Ludwigsburg. Well, I can't agree. All these years, I thought that we were in the marshalling yards of Stuttgart. So we got in this boxcar, and there must have been over 50 men that were jammed in here. Well, then they locked the door, And there's nothing in there, there's no place to relieve yourself except a crack in the door. And so that was a designated latrine, if you say, you want to say. And somewhere there was a bucket. I guess it was near the door, I don't know. But I wasn't too far from the door, so that wasn't too good a spot, maybe. And we were in this car, and the door was locked, and like we didn't ever move, and then all of a sudden, through the cracks in this boxcar, you could see the engineer leave the train, and they and whoever was soldiers were all going somewhere, and there was an air raid, and so they strafed this area, and looking through the cracks, you could see other cars with some flatbeds, cars, railroad cars with military equipment on it. And so they were some American, I guess American, planes were strafing. Anyway, it was like you when you're in there and you wonder, boy, those 50 calibers coming through that boxcar would just be terrible. Well, they never did hit the car, so we were lucky. And so finally, we departed going somewhere. Well, we were in there for about 2 days, and it was cold. I mean, this is, you know, the day we were captured, I think it was about 15 degrees, and that's cold, lying in the snow. Well, finally, we arrived, and it was in Falling Basel, Germany. So we had gone from way down by Stuttgart all the way up north towards Hamburg almost, and north of Hanover. When I know that for now later, I didn't know at the time, but that's where we ended up in Falling Basel, the town of Falling Basel, which had a Stalag 11B, was the Stalag there, big prison camp. And we found out it had all kinds of prisoners. In one section it had all Russians, and I guess there were British in there. But we were put in, we were deliced at that time, and I ended up with a wooden dog tag saying I was a prisoner of war. And so I had my number, and here's a verification that I got later on of my time in the British, in the German camp here. But I was, and we were lucky, a few of us volunteered for a work detail. And so in about 2 weeks we shipped out, and I've been told we were in a boxcar again to get to Hanover. I'm not sure whether we were or not, and that's still a question in my mind, and I don't know if I'll ever get that proven, but it was about a day trip to Hanover. And so we end up in as a work detail, 100 Americans, and maybe a little over 100. But we ended up, and we were taken to this schoolhouse in Meseberg, Germany, just a suburb of Hanover. And that started our little experience of chipping bricks in a benzene refinery, where we were given piles of brick and we were to chip off the concrete and the cement and sand, whatever was on it, and pile them up. And so we had a chipper that they gave us, a metal chipper, and So we, this schoolhouse, we lived in the gymnasium of this schoolhouse, and the there was a guy who spoke German very well in our midst, and so he was sort of was the leader because he could communicate with the, and he was a good guy to communicate with the Germans. And so it was just like being in a prison camp, but they brought in soup at night from some kitchen somewhere in a thermos, big thermos containers. And they, in the morning we had, usually had a loaf of bread that was split up. So we had groups of prisoners, and we were all in groups of eight people and had to split the bread eight ways. So by the time you got that prisoner loaf, and if you could cut it, they were really hard, and so you'd cut it anyway. So you'd end up with a piece of bread that was fairly ample. You know, it, you could have a big bite of it. And then we were given margarine at different times, and which added to the, it was white margarine, so it wasn't colored like butter. So anyway, but the ersatz coffee we got was boiled barley or something, I'm not sure what it was. It was some sort of, it must have, it was really hot most of the time, so that was really a good morning. I never complained about the food because it's what we got. I had to accept it. And thing was, we tried to figure out whether to eat the bread all at once or save it. So when we'd go out chipping bricks, and in the benzene refinery where we did our work was maybe 2 miles away from the schoolhouse. Well, we first, when we first got there, we rode on a streetcar that was had boards on it, and they would take us to work a couple of miles, wherever it was. And so that was a pretty good deal. We didn't have to work or walk all that ways. And then at work, I oftentimes took the bread, and I somehow I got this knife, because you had to have a knife to cut the bread. Some way you had to have a knife to cut that bread. And anyway, so I got this knife from, I traded it for some, from somebody. And I'd get to the place where we worked, and made enough bricks so you could sit on them, and then enough to put the brick on to work on it. And I particularly just liked to sit there for a long time, just making designs in the brick. And by 9 o'clock, and I still had my watch, by 9 o'clock the first air raid would happen. At 9 o'clock every morning we had an air raid. Sirens. Sometimes we never saw a plane, but we had an air raid. There was a raid somewhere. And so we left our work spot. Guards ended up going one way, we'd go the other way. We'd go down in this railroad area, and it was in like a quarry, and there was a big cave over on one side, and it wasn't too far from where we were doing the work. But all the slave labor and other nationalities would go in this cave, and sort of a railroad tunnel, I guess it was, as a means of protection in air raids. Direct hits might have been pretty bad, but anyway, that's where we mingled, and if you had anything of worth, you could trade with all these guys. And the Polish prisoners, they were big on trading there. But anyway, we all clear would sign with sound, and we'd go back to the work spot, and the guards would be there, and then the foreman was an old guy, and he looked like a walrus. He had this white mustache and no front teeth, like eye teeth, and so we'd call him the walrus, but he would get mad at me because I wasn't doing a lot of work. He could finally caught up to me, and so he wanted me to, you know, probably move bricks or pick up the bricks at the people. Are we over time? Okay. And I rebelled, and he took the chipper away from me, and he wanted me to carry bricks. Well, then I'd go in this big tank that was all bombed out and disappear for a while, and then another air raid would happen. So I got my chipper back finally. And so, but anyway, that was an interesting time. And our schoolhouse, where at night we had dug a trench to protect us from bombers at night, and that's what it was for. And so at one time I was put on work detail. Instead of going chipping bricks, I'd dig all day this trench. Well, the other people did that too, and this one night, we saw all kinds of bombing, but this one night the British came over, and they dropped flares when they were about ready to bomb. They dropped these flares, and it lit up. It was just like noontime. I mean, it was the scariest deal. And we had air raids every night, but not right there. All of a sudden, they're going to bomb right where we were working, which is a couple of miles away. But anyway, bombs started coming down. And it wasn't like, you know, a whistle or anything. It was just this massive sound that you hear. I mean, it's bigger than all these bombs are coming down. Well, when they hit, man, there was a lot of noise, but it wasn't on us. But flak was raining down on us a little bit, so I guess no one really got hurt from that. But the next morning when we went to work, we went right through this. We were walking then, and then we went right through this area and down by this railroad. And down there, the railroad tracks were up in the air and all bombed up, and there was a crew in there. They had a machine gun up on this roadway that we walked across, you know, aimed down in this valley where they had all these workers and a lot of American troops were in that work detail on that railroad. They weren't us. They were some other contingent that worked on repairing railroad tracks. But they were Americans in that case, so they had to repair this area. Well, they did in about 2 days. They had that going, so it's amazing how they recover fast. Anyway, we had air raids every day, and so that was eventful, and Easter came, and the guards gave us some marmalade and some sugar that day, but no bread. And it was cold and raining, and that was on the 1st of April, 1945, Easter. We had a day off, two in a row at that time, and there was definitely they heard artillery firing, and Jerry was, who we called the Germans, Jerry, started kissing. I mean, they were, you could tell that they were trying to be a little nicer than, and I don't say that they were really bad to us any time, particularly in this place. And somewhere during this time, I sold my watch for what I thought was 14 loaves of bread and a can of butter. However, I never got it. But I got a loaf of bread. And so anyway, so everything started happening fast after this, because we soon evacuated Hanover. And at that time, we had a way out of our this gymnasium we're in. There was a stage, and there was an opening that went under the stage, and actually there was a window that got out, and we could have escaped any time, really. Yet it was, weather was so bad, and to escape into the big city of Hanover seemed like a, unless you had a good plan, it would be a bad place to be running around. And so I never chose to do it. Well, anyway, when we evacuated, there were at least 14 men that did, that we accounted for. The 14 men left and did that. And I think we had some report later that some got through all right, but I don't know about that. And so we evacuated and started walking northeast out of Hanover. And we went up, and we went by Celle, S-C-E-L-L-E, prominent little town. And so we were walking northeast out of this area, and in living by the alongside the road, I mean, we'd stop in a barn or someplace in some field, and of course we didn't have any blankets with us or anything, but here we're living, somehow we're existing.